live to tape.
Welcome to Millennials, Season 2, Episode 19. I'm Andrew.
I'm Elisa.
I'm Laura.
And I'm Matt.
We have two graduates among us, and they are definitely not Matt and I.
No, because we're men.
What does that mean?
Congrats, Laura and Elisa, on both graduating the past week. That's wonderful.
Thank you.
Thanks, yeah.
How does it feel to graduate? Tell Matt and I.
Yes.
It feels like,
please, let us live it.
It feels like indentured servitude, like I just spent $80,000 on a piece of paper.
Did they actually give you anything during your ceremony, Elisa?
No, I didn't get shit. I got flowers. That's the most expensive roses I've ever gotten in my life.
And you got some Facebook likes?
Yeah, but you know.
You got a nice hat.
Yeah, but we had to pay for that. But you like here's
yeah, but it's still here, nice.
Here's the thing. So like during most normal graduation ceremonies, they give you like an empty diploma holder because it takes them a couple months to print up your diploma. So like when they give it to you on the stage, it's like they're giving you a diploma, but not. Well, yeah. Columbia couldn't even be bothered to do that. They gave us instead a pin, like a little like dollar store looking pin that we could pin on our robes. And we were all just like, okay.
No. Should have just stabbed them in the eye with it. I'm like, I don't need this.
That whole thing about not giving you your actual diploma at graduation is so stupid to me because it's like, you know, you graduated on time. Can they get your diploma together on time?
No.
Why do they do that? Like, to make sure you've graduated before they waste their time getting it printed?
All they have to do is just have them printed.
Well, technically, you can actually walk
take a day.
Commencement. Without graduating, because it's still oftentimes your grades aren't in by the time graduation comes. So I actually know people who've walked commencement at their colleges and then not graduated.
Huh.
Oh, that's amazing. Yeah.
But you weren't one of those people.
I was not. No. I hope not.
You were one of those people with green hair at your graduation. But if I look at your photo, it looks like it was photoshopped.
Yeah. So this fucking pisses me off. Okay. This is some Ivy League bullshit right here. So the week before I graduated, I got my hair dyed green. I look like a Marvel superhero, according to Elisa. And I was super excited to have this for my graduation. They had professional photographers there at the event. And yesterday they sent me a link to my graduation photos in which they photoshopped my hair brown. I'm fucking pissed.
Did you call the photographer and ask what the hell?
Not yet. I'm too lazy.
That's like something that you do for like high school, like class pictures. You don't do that for a graduation for your master's.
Right. I was like, clearly I wanted it to be that color.
Right. You really should speak to them. I mean, that's like censorship or something.
I know.
That's wrong.
It just fucking figures. Whatever.
Hashtag green hair rights.
Anyway.
Well, your hair looks great.
Thank you.
Matt, you were in San Diego for a Beyonce concert. How was that?
It was pretty amazing, yeah. I gotta say. No, it was honestly an amazing experience. I live in LA, but the reason why I wanted to go to San Diego was that the venue in San Diego has about 25,000 less seats than the venue I have here in LA. But no, it was great. What are you laughing at, Andrew?
I'm laughing at this is such a like a super fan commentary. I went to the venue that was 2 hours further away from my house because it was smaller, more intimate event.
You know, this is pretty rich coming from someone who flies across the entire country.
Oh, no. I know. And that's why I'm laughing.
Bruce Springsteen.
I would do this as well. I would do this as well. It's just funny
hearing
somebody
else say it. Well, you did, though. I mean, you did see her concert, too. You saw it in L.A.
Yeah, I went to the Rose Bowl. I did not drive down to San Diego. And, yeah, it was good. You know what kind of bothered me about it, though? It's not the full songs. It's like all these little samples of the songs.
She sang 30 songs.
Yeah. Well, yeah. 30 half songs.
Beyonce's not going to sing a full song.
Why not?
What?
Because she has so many songs to sing. She has a shit ton.
Yeah. Well, I get it. I get why it's like a show perspective. It's for the show. And that's,
but you know, okay, but she didn't sing all the songs completely, but she did sing a couple. I mean, not a couple, but she sang a good amount. There are songs that she stopped or she skipped a chorus for, but
mm-hmm. Right.
I mean, it was still fucking amazing.
Yeah, it was really good. I got drunk, so that was fun.
Yeah, I was on something. but she really delivers, and it really kind of goes to show like why people say like she is one of the best entertainers of our generation.
Mm-hmm. Elisa, since you've been off these past 2 weeks, we need to get a couple of updates from you before we move into hidden from the headlines and news. The last time we spoke with you, Trump was not the presumptive nominee. Cruz and Kasich still existed. So how are you feeling now?
How are you holding up?
God, how long have I been off this show? You know, this whole Trump situation reminds me of like, you wake up one morning and you feel like a weird cramp in your side and everyone's telling you like, oh no, don't worry about it. It'll be fine. You know, and you just get through the day and it gets worse and worse. And finally you go to the doctor and it turns out it's cancer, except like our body in this case is the American Republic and the cancer is Donald Trump. And it's time we really take that very seriously.
Yeah.
I feel like it's way past time. Like if at this point we're still kind of laughing about it, like, oh, it could never happen, then we're the fools. And the words of George Bush, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about. it's just, I will say though, like that, like the need to take it seriously aside, I was kind of surprised when Cruz dropped as quickly as he did, because there was a lot of people were saying that he was going to contest this at the convention and he was going to try.
He was saying that.
I'm sorry?
He was saying it too.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, he was saying it. I mean, a lot of people I know who are, you know, work for the RNC were saying that. So we were all really taken aback by it. But I mean, fuck.
Yeah.
Well, what are your thoughts on, actually, we haven't really even really talked about this, but like, what are your guys' thoughts on Donald Trump posing as John Miller as a publicist?
Yeah, that was weird. I think it definitely sounds like him just based on the words he uses on the call. That's what confirmed it to me, because his voice doesn't really sound like him. Granted, it was like 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. But just the way he spoke, you could tell it was him.
He also admitted it. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
He said it was a joke.
It's obviously him, but I'm kind of annoyed that everyone even gives a shit. Okay, so he poses as somebody on a telephone call X number of years ago. We can't find anything else to pin this guy for? He's a psychopath. Why do we keep talking about this? Like, I understand that it's a controversy or whatever, but like, he 2 months ago, he's like, oh, kick out all the Muslims. Like, why is that not on our radar anymore, but this phone call is?
Well, every time he says something crazy, you think that, oh, this is gonna do it. This is gonna be the end of Trump. Or at least that's how I used to think. But now it's like nothing can stop him. Nothing.
Everything that has happened to Donald Trump that the media and the public has thrown at him, for any other candidate, it would have torpedoed into oblivion. But literally nothing could destroy Donald Trump at this point.
I think a good sex scandal might be able to.
But I don't think so.
Anything else? No.
I think like a cockroach, Donald Trump could survive a nuclear holocaust.
Ooh, interesting. Interesting analogy.
Mm-hmm. Someone just needs to turn on the lights.
So, one other thing. We had a patron request, Elisa, real quick. She wanted to know, Amanda wanted to know your thoughts on the Ilvermorny house names.
Oh. I just wish she wouldn't. Like,
you don't want houses? You don't want anything North America?
No, I wish that she wouldn't. They're terrible names, and I feel like it's sort of just copying Hogwarts. Uh-huh. And I wish that if there was going to be an American school, that's great, that's fine, but it needs to be something different. It needs to be a little bit more original than what the fuck. I don't even remember what the names are, other than the fact that I'm apparently like a troll creature or something. whatever the Hufflepuff, like, however that translates over, it turns out that I have, like, green, smooth skin, and I'm a troll.
Well,
it's like puff wedgie, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Or horned serpent. Like, it's a description.
Like, this was Thunderbird. My chance, guys. This was my yeah. chance. I've been a fucking Hufflepuff for years, and I have to live with that. And now I come to America, and I'm thinking, okay, this is like the land of the free, home of the brave. I'm going to get some, like, finally some badass shit. And it turns out I'm a troll.
It turns out we're contestants on Legends of the Hidden Temple.
It's even worse than being a Hufflepuff.
I think that we will, once we learn more about these, once they're formalized, once J.K. Rowling shares more information, we'll be feeling better about them. I mean, really, we haven't felt better about any new phrase from the Wizarding World. All right, well, we're caught up with you, Lisa, now. Unless you have anything else to add. Has anything else been bugging you these past couple weeks?
The fact that I haven't been on the show.
Good answer.
Yeah, I think that's what I'm supposed to say. I'll have to check with my publicist.
Yeah, we sent you that email.
Okay, thanks, guys. I think we want to talk about this story, though. This is our Hidden from the Headlines for this week, and I have no idea why it's not being covered at all. But just this past week, there was a massive oil spill in the Gulf of Mexico, about 100 miles south of Louisiana. And 90,000 gallons of oil has spilled out so far. The crazy thing about this, first of all, it should come as a surprise to nobody that this is Shell oil. But this isn't from our oil rig. This is actually just a standard oil pipeline underneath of the ocean floor. And it burst and no one knew about it. It was leaking for days and Shell didn't know. Nobody knew until a random helicopter, like a military helicopter, was flying over and they saw 90,000 gallons of oil floating on the surface and thought, that's kind of weird. Yeah. And they called it in. So that's how we found out. There was like no safety mechanisms. There was no alarm that went off. It's just gushing oil. And thankfully, they've cleaned most of it up from the surface. And because it's 100 miles out from the shore, it's not going to impact, you know, shoreline marine life. But obviously, it will still impact the greater ecosystem. So, I'm really surprised that I haven't seen anything about this. Have you guys?
No. Maybe if the oil floated to New Orleans, then we would be hearing about it.
Yeah.
I know Anderson Cooper loves NOLA.
I saw it on Reddit, but that was not even for a full day. Like, it wasn't even on the top front page.
It reminds you, you know, the few of the presidential candidates are reminding us about our crumbling infrastructure. And that's a good reminder of this. I mean, here in L.A., you see stories all the time, not about gas pipes breaking. Well, there have been those.
They're just not sexy stories.
No, but the water pipes under the city break all the time. And it's because they're old as hell and they're not upgraded. And I'm sure this happens all around the country too. And of course, you know, if a water pipe bursts, it's not necessarily going to damage the environment like an oil spill, of course. But it's just reminders that all these pipes under the ground right now are really all old as hell.
Yeah.
I think part of it is too that people don't see the long lasting effects of these types of oil spills. Like, I'm thinking back to the BP oil spill in 2010 in the Gulf of Mexico that was fucking horrendous. But people go to those beaches now and they look okay to kind of the naked eye. But like, I grew up on those beaches and I know for a fact that if you dig into the sand, like a foot and a half, 2 feet down, you will find fucking tar balls from that oil spill. Yeah. And there was this species of coquino shell that lived on the entire Gulf Coast. Really, really beautiful, like little shells that live in the surf, and they're gone. They're completely gone at this point. And I just think that people, they hear these stories and they stick in their mind for the 24-hour news cycle, and then they're gone because they're not hearing about the long-term effects.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. I actually want to ask you guys, I want you guys to guess a number, okay? So there's been X number of oil spills in the past 4 years. What do you think that figure is?
Worldwide?
No, just in the United States.
Hmm.
Actually, no, I'm lying. Just in the Gulf of Mexico alone.
Well, if we're including all of them, I it's probably, I'm going to guess like 110.
Okay.
I was going to say somewhere in the 200 to 300 range.
Okay. Matt?
15,000.
I was hoping you'd go really low. Like
you guys, yeah, you kind of steal the thunder here a little bit. 147 oil spills in the Gulf of Mexico alone. And that's
there you
with,
go, Andrew.
Yeah, yeah, Andrew was close. If you win, if this is like Price is Right.
I was doing worldwide.
Oh, okay. Sure you were.
Too late. Fault.
But that's still a lot. 147 oil spills just in the Gulf alone. That's a lot. Yeah. And I mean, we have, like, nobody talks about any of them pretty much. 147 oil spills, and that's 500,000 gallons of oil. And that's, listen, that's just in the past 4 years, you know? Yeah. It's pretty significant.
I think the fact that it was contained is when, like, no one really gave a shit. No matter, like, what the long-term effects or even short-term effects of it are, there's nothing really to report, they think, because it's technically contained.
So let's move on to some other news. We're going to start with a developing story. A plane went down. a plane went down.
Yay!
Wow, Andrew.
A plane went down Wednesday on a route between Paris and Egypt. 66 people were on board the flight. It was an Airbus A320. It was Egypt Air, that airline. So this story is still very new. Details will change probably by the time you listen to this. But the latest development is that they thought they found some wreckage. And Egypt Air officially even said, hey, we found some wreckage. We're sorry to all the loved ones. You know, basically confirming that they found a crashed plane. Well, turns out that wasn't true. When researchers got close to the debris found in the Mediterranean Sea, they realized it didn't come from the missing airliner. So now, as of right now, as of Thursday night, it's still technically missing. So, scary situation. It may be terrorism. Donald Trump is already calling it terrorism, but,
cause it's easier to say
that. Yeah. Well, and he gets more voters that way too. Just blaming terrorists. Of course, it's a very real possibility, and it's kind of become the norm, hasn't it? We were talking about this in our private Facebook group this morning.
Yeah, I've just decided to never fly again because this used to be a rarity. It used to be genuinely, you know, it was an anomaly for a plane to go down or to go missing. And now it's like, oh, what day is it? It's Wednesday. We're overdue. And I'm just not doing it.
But the thing is that a lot of these have been happening in, like, in Asia and now more like the Middle East and Africa. They don't have the kind of TSA regulations that America has, or at least even Western countries.
Well, the thing to point out though is this Air Egypt flight left from Charles de Gaulle Airport in Paris, and that airport has extremely strict security.
That's what I hate about this. Paris. Yeah. This happened in Paris. This terrorism essentially happened in Paris. So that is very scary. I mean, it certainly doesn't make me feel comfortable about flying to London in 2 weeks.
But we also don't know exactly what happened either. So
no, of course,
no, we don't.
You know, maybe it could have been a true plane accident. We remember that flight where this stupid pilot like wanted to off himself, so he decided to fly to the side of a mountain. A year or two ago.
Or flight MH370 or whatever the number is.
Yeah, it's still
that
lost.
We still don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, that's because that flight is now. It went into a black hole. I don't know if you saw that episode of Don Lemon, but
he did,
that one for us. No,
well,
I mean,
he'll be
the
asking
only
that
thing,
question tonight.
I would say the only thing that we know at this point, right, is that the radar is showing that the plane made a bunch of really sharp turns and pitches right before it went down, correct?
Yes, it did. It did drop dramatically. I did read that at one point. So you're suggesting it's...
Well, they seem to think it's very likely that it was a bomb.
Oh, a bomb.
Yeah.
Not good.
But Laura, you brought up a good point earlier when we were talking about this, and you were saying that if it was terrorism, this doesn't really have the same tenor as most terrorist attacks.
Yeah. So when I first heard that they thought it might be terrorism, I was a little confused because just over my lifetime, I've been used to seeing acts of terror trying to be very almost, and I hate to use this word, but like almost very spectacular and very bombastic. In that they're doing things in very, in very public, urban, highly populated areas. And the idea of crashing a plane in the ocean doesn't really seem like their MO. But of course, right. You know, there are just a million possibilities to explain why that might have happened if it was terrorism. So we're just going to have to wait and see.
Yeah. 9/11, they purposely did that in the 9 a.m. hour because of shows like the Today Show and whatnot. They purposely did it in New York because, you know, it's very, very symbolic of America. They purposely flew into the World Trade Centers. It was just very, it was extremely well orchestrated down to what time the planes would crash. So it would be covered on all the channels, all the programs.
Yeah. And going off that too, that, you know, the attack in Paris and, you know, the 9/11 attacks, that we did get like a terrorist organization who did like take responsibility for it too. And we haven't heard anything from any of the organizations. And it's been almost a full day and no one has claimed responsibility of this as being a terrorist attack. So that could be a good indication that maybe this wasn't exactly a well conceived attack from like ISIS or other terrorist organizations.
Maybe it was one of those lone terrorists. Maybe associated with ISIS loosely.
Could be.
You know, that's what has
the
been
San Bernardino
here in America. Exactly. Yeah. These lone terrorists going rogue, kind of doing it on their own. Anyway.
Yeah. Well, I think we're just gonna have to wait and see.
Elisa, how serious are you about not flying anymore? Like, are you kind of kidding or?
I'm like 80% serious.
Is that why all of our trips now are coming to you?
Yes, that's why for the election, you guys, you assholes are getting on the plane. I'll pick you up in my car.
Oh, I get to fly to DC? Sounds great.
Yeah. Like, legitimately, you'll love it.
No terrorist would want to be on a flight to DC.
I don't know. DC is not that significant of a city or anything.
It's not during a pretty good event or anything.
No, it's not like it's a, you know, an important election in an important city. You'll be fine.
That's why my new car actually, have you guys heard of those aqueducts? What are they called? Something ducks, like they can ride on the road and in the water.
Yeah,
They're like in Seattle and Philly and stuff. So my car can do that, and that's actually how I'm getting to London now. I just decided.
Okay.
That's why I bought a new car.
But you're in California.
Yeah, well, I'm going to drive it over to, like, New York and then boat the rest of the way.
I will paddle my ass in a box.
Are you flying?
That's definitely
before
safer.
I fucking fly. Listen, it feels like it.
Yeah. You guys want to know something? What was that attack, the terrorist attack, gosh, about a month ago? Abroad. It was a big
one
2 months ago. Yeah, I know, right? Anyway, well, after that, it got a lot of, you know, media attention here. After that, my dad texted me. He's like, you know, you really shouldn't go over to London. And you shouldn't go to the Bruce Springsteen concert because he thinks terrorists are going to bomb the London Bruce Springsteen concert because it's like, you know, blowing up the big American hero. And he's right. I think it is a great target for terrorists, but I'm still going.
Oh, Jesus.
No, you should still go. You can't let these assholes stop you from living your life. And if you
are
too afraid to fly or you're too afraid to go to big events that you would normally otherwise go to, then you let them win.
Right. And then what's the point of living if you're always living in fear?
Right.
That's what I told my dad, who lives in fear and hasn't flown in forever.
I mean, I'll be alive. I'll be alive to see the next season of Orphan Black, so.
Yeah. You'll be alive, but have you actually lived? Oh my god, are we talking about Orphan Black?
I'll be super alive in my bed in Netflix while you guys are losing limbs. That's fine.
I've been joking to my dad. I'm like, Dad, I'll make it to Becca's wedding in October. I may be missing a leg, but I'll be there.
I may be there in spirit only. I may be there as a literal specter, but that'll be fine.
I may be there as a picture.
As a picture surrounded by candles. That will be how I arrive.
a hybrid, a wedding funeral hybrid would be kind of cool.
You'd be great. Yeah, she can carry.
You wouldn't even be there to enjoy it.
Just, you know, how they usually like throw out rice at the end of the wedding? It'll just be your ashes instead.
This episode's going to be awesome when I die in London, and then you guys can all play it and Anderson Cooper can listen to it. Hey, Anderson. Love you. Okay, so let's watch some other news.
All right, so this... President Obama just announced a new executive action that's going to change U.S. labor law as of December 1st. Under this action, more than 4 million salaried employees will be eligible for overtime pay. Currently, only salaried employees making less than $23,700 a year are eligible, but now anyone making less than $47,500 a year will be eligible. So the Obama administration says that this move is going to increase wages nationwide by about $1.2 billion a year. Pretty significant. And you know, the reason that he's doing this is partly because there's been no movement on minimum wage. And so he feels like the least they could do is make overtime a reality for more Americans. And currently, for example, let's say that you were only making $25,000 a year and you were working 60 hours a week. If you're on salary, that's just what you get. Yeah. And that's it. You're not the 20 hour difference between 40 hours and 60. You don't get extra for that. But now under this new rule, you know, the threshold is increased. And so if you are making anything less than $47,000, your employer has to pay you overtime. So it's a pretty big deal, and it's getting a lot of flack. There's a lot of debate on it, but what are you guys' like initial reactions?
I know a couple people who are salaried and work a lot of extra hours, my boyfriend included. And I think this is great, because if you're working these long hours, like Mike in particular works a couple nights a week on occasion during the busy season with his job, you should be getting paid for it. I mean, come on. It seems really stupid, I think, that people, if you're salaried, are not getting paid for this extra time you're putting in. So I'm all about it.
Yeah, I totally agree. Yeah, I have a friend who is a restaurant manager, and he was talking on Facebook the other day about how he makes $32,000 a year, but he works 60-hour work weeks, which is insane. Yeah. To be making that little money for putting in that many hours. So this is going to make a huge difference for him and his family.
Yeah, I think really it's the hospitality industry, the food and beverage industry, and the retail industry too, that's really going to be influenced on this. And it does make me nervous though, for what the repercussions of this is going to be for like the staff and other employees that will benefit from this, from what like the companies are going to do in retaliation for it.
What could they do though? Because they can't get rid of the people. They still need the people working these hours. Are they gonna, because it's 47.5 or less. So, yeah, I don't
know. They say that they could, the argument against this is that they'll still have to keep the same number of employees, but maybe they won't hire more. So now we're going to see a stagnation in people being hired. So there, you know, job growth will slow down.
People said that about Obamacare too.
I know. But like, listen, in all fairness, like, I support this as well. But in fairness, this is a pretty serious regulation. Even Democrats have been historically opposed to regulating labor law this way. I mean, as far back as, I mean, forever, but even as recently as Clinton, the party platform has been very stringently, no, we're going to pass laws. We're in favor of regulation if it's like the environment or healthcare, but labor laws, we can't really justify that. And this is executive action. This is just like him laying down the hammer, man. Like there's no legislating in this process. So it is kind of heavy-handed. Even if you support it, and I do, it is very heavy-handed.
But a lot of people are going to be appreciative, I hope. I think.
Well, and also to be fair, the White House acknowledges in their statement, they said, listen, we know there's going to be some people out there who are going to have their hours cut as a result of this. But that's not necessarily a terrible thing. For some people, it will be. But for other people, the idea is that you free up time for yourself to, you can either work a second job or you can go and acquire new skills. You can go back to school. You can go train yourself and advance and not have to be stuck in a shitty position your whole life. Yeah. So their argument is, we understand that some people might not be working as much and might be taking a bit of a salary cut, maybe. But even then, like, you're freeing up your life to go do other things that could advance yourself.
Yeah. Exactly. Carrying over this theme of working across the pond, France is considering a bill that would make it illegal to send or receive work emails after regular business hours. The legislation would only apply to companies with more than 50 employees to ensure small businesses and startups are still permitted to put in the work necessary to advance. But large companies would be forced to respect their employees' downtime, say the proponents who argue that the law would put the responsibility of balancing work on bosses rather than on employees. So this is really interesting.
I love this. Well, we've spoken about life-work balance before. I think this is great. it's just amusing that they would go this far to make it illegal. Like, that's very strong.
I am totally in support of this, but I want to kind of play devil's advocate here a little bit. So, how does this work in our increasingly global world where we're connected to people on the other side of the planet? So, like, if I run a business and a lot of my clients are in China, but then I'm not allowed to check my email at night, how do I talk to my clients?
You talk to them. I mean, the conversation may move slower, but you worry about it the next day.
Yeah, but the next day is their night.
And then they worry about it the next day.
But that's your night and you can't email.
No, but I'm saying the conversation will move slower, but it will move just slower.
I think this is a little too, talk about heavy-handedness. I think this is a little too heavy-handed for me personally. I think it's one thing to incentivize bosses to consider work-life balance. I think, for example, you can do what Obama did and, you know, create better wages for overtime. So they could be, France could be saying, all right, like, after hour emails are going to count as overtime, that counts as working, and you have to pay your people twice as much for that. Now you're still allowed to do it. You still have the option. And if you are working in like a global firm, like Laura's pointing out, you know, you can do it. You can keep pace with the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. But you're going to be compensated for it. So bosses still have an incentive to consider you and to consider work-life balance, but at least it's not just straight up illegal. That seems a little weird to me, to be honest.
Well, this really reminds me of that movie, The Devil Wears Prada, with Anne Hathaway being constantly told what to do by her boss, even when she's at home or constantly just working. And which allows her not to have like any space for, you know, a life outside of work.
Well, it is important to point out that this bill is going into France's Senate right now. So it hasn't been passed yet. So it's still under consideration. And I suppose there is a chance that this won't ultimately make it through their Senate. But yeah, I just can't imagine how this would work for any kind of globally connected company.
I mean, the people, the article I read about this actually was even saying that the sector that's probably going to be impacted by this the most is the nonprofit sector, because most nonprofits, at least, you know, the major ones, of course, they do have more than 50 employees, and nonprofits, by their very nature, don't pay very much and they sort of demand long hours. I mean, people are stretched very thin, but it's rewarding. You're doing something that you're passionate about. And they definitely send emails and work after hours all the time. And so it's kind of going to impact the very sector that we admire and rely on so much. I mean, if, you know, the fucking Red Cross or Doctors Without Borders or whatever, if they can't send an email at 9 p.m., I don't know. Well,
the things that go on with these companies don't really work during regular business hours. They work whenever like something gets brought up. Like there isn't a 9 to 5 shift where like these companies get all of their business done. It's really just waiting until, you know, something is relayed back to them and then they start working on it then.
Andrew's like, no, fuck it. I still don't want to send an email.
I still think that work-life balance is important.
Oh, it totally is.
Maybe they'll add some exceptions here or something for globally connected companies, as you guys say. But
for
then
podcasts.
It's like, what's, for podcasts, yeah.
Yeah, but mm-hmm. we have less than 50 employees, so we'll be okay.
Maybe people will circumvent it by, well, first of all, how are they going to find out? Is France going to be watching your email for things going in and out? That seems like.
That's true. How would they enforce this?
It's probably a human resource kind of situation where like an employee goes to HR.
Yeah.
My boss sent me an email at 8:50 last night.
Maybe they'll circumvent it by like talking over the phone or fax or Telegram or. I don't know. Something.
What's
Telegram?
No, I think they should just really focus on like sexual harassment in the workplace or something else than sending emails or talking about work outside of the business hours. Like, isn't that what people do when they coworkers do anyways when they go out to have a drink after work? All they do is bitch about work.
True. True.
Ugh. Anyways. All right. Moving on to the most important stuff this week. Thomas Manning of Halifax, Massachusetts is the first man to receive a penis transplant in the United States.
Nice.
We did it, guys. We did it.
Well done. Go team.
Manning lost his appendage from cancer, penile cancer, a couple years ago, but is now in remission, and he is the third man in the entire world to have the experimental surgery performed. The 15-hour operation involved more than 50 doctors from many departments, including urology, psychiatry, plastic surgery, and some other shit. The donor was a deceased man who volunteered his body to science before his death. But Mr. Manning's wanted to speak publicly about his experience, so he'd hope it could remove the stigma of genital injury and inspire other men to remain hopeful about recovery. His transplanted penis currently has good blood flow so far and shows no signs of rejection.
How did he find out?
You know how he found out.
I think he saw it. There's 50 people looking at his junk, so I think he's got enough eyes on it.
I think Matt did an investigative report on this.
I did, actually. I have some numbers if you guys want some.
He got up close and personal.
Yeah. But the thing I found out about this, too, is that even if, like, everything goes according to plan, like, you know, his junk doesn't get rejected, his new junk, he has to take, like, medication every single day to keep that from...
falling off?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or
that and other things, like infection and stuff. Like, it's almost kind of like HIV medication where you have to like take it literally every single day to keep yourself from dying.
Well, you have to do that anytime you get an organ transplant. You always have to take anti-rejection drugs. So in that regard, this is no different than getting a heart transplant.
It really isn't.
You know how you go to like a really nice jewelry store and they're showing you the jewelry and the girl behind the counter puts on like these velvet gloves to hold the jewelry with, right? Mm-hmm. I imagine at some point in the near future, his wife will have to have those gloves to show his or to touch his penis. I imagine her like putting his new dick on like this velvet pillow and being like, and this here is our crown jewel. This is our new penis in the family. Like, I would be terrified that it would just like snap off in the middle of sex or something.
Well, they're saying that, you know, if all goes well, he would be able to have, like, you know, sex.
Well, I would hope so.
He would
so.
Be able to use it. He still needs to urinate, though. Like, that's one of the baby steps.
That's not important, really.
What I find also interesting about this is that it's not only increasingly, like, you know, rare to have this kind of procedure because it's very experimental, but it's also incredibly difficult to get a donor for a penis.
Yeah, because no one's like, hey, yeah, take my dick when I die. This goes back to what we were talking about, organ donation, you know, like, mm-hmm. I don't know, a month or so ago. I mean, Does this count? Like when you're checking that little box?
Yeah, no, it doesn't. It's different. When a person dies, the family is asked to give permission. Like they're saying, like so and so gave permission for his organs, but a separate question has to be asked about his genitals. It's not part of the same category.
Interesting.
So. Yeah, so it's actually a touchy subject for some family members, where especially like their partners, where it's kind of like a psychological, it's like a psychological fight to be okay with allowing your loved one to donate their junk, their penis or vagina.
Listen, I mean, if there's any part of your body that you want to go on after you die, would it not be your dick?
Yeah, I was just about to say, Laura, if anything happens to me, you can have my puss.
Yeah, especially when guys are very, I mean, from the internet, I can only speak for myself, but a lot of men are very proud of their dick.
My question is, did he get a larger dick or a smaller dick?
It'd be interesting if there was like a catalog that you could pick from.
Yeah, yeah, it'll shop around.
Yeah, and there's a woman holding each dick with velvet gloves. And she's showcasing them to you.
Let the wife pick. Was he married? The wife should pick.
It would also be interesting. I mean, it would also be interesting.
Technically jerking someone else's dick.
Yeah. It'd be interesting if the dick were from somebody of a different race, too.
Oh, that'd be cool. That'd be so cool. I mean, imagine writing about that on your OkCupid profile.
I wonder how that really works, because I wonder how, like race really plays into. Like appendages and things. Like if there's a different makeup of cells or something.
Well,
like
no,
pigments.
I was just more referring to if there would be any visible discernible difference in skin tone and stuff. Like if this dude was I don't know.
Well, there would be.
Yeah, exactly. Like if this dude was I don't know, white, and he got a black guy's dick, it would be kind of funny.
Yeah.
Do you think when he starts jerking off, he's gonna feel gay?
What? Why?
Because it's someone else's
penis. Someone else's dick. Do you think when he's going to jerk it, he's like, oh god, I guess I'm gay now.
Oh my god.
Stranger in the tub.
I don't know. I don't want to know.
I think he's just happy that he has a dick.
These are the hard-hitting questions that Anderson Cooper should be asking.
Only we ask here on Millennial.
Millennial.
You forgot the show for a second, didn't you?
No, of course not. All right, so
you're on MuggleCast. These are the questions.
Why are we talking about dicks on MuggleCast?
I don't know why you guys didn't start talking about that MuggleCast a long time ago. But it's just me.
We did, just not on air. So let's move on now to No Context. We haven't played this in a while. how it works is I'm going to play a couple songs and we have to connect them with the topics we've discussed today. So yes. Let's start with a quote unquote new hit.
You obviously are not a fan of the song then.
Well, yeah, you're right. Okay. This is the new Justin Timberlake song, Can't Stop the Feeling.
I already know what this is.
Yeah, me too.
I got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, wavy when I turn it on.
This is
off from my city, off from my home. We're flying up, no ceiling when we in our zone. I got that sunshine in my pocket, got that good soul in my feet. Feel that hot flush in my body when it drops. Ooh, I can't take my eyes off of it.
All right, Elisa, you please, you go first.
This is 100%. I mean, I've got sunshine in my pocket. I got a hard on in my pants. This is for sure the guy with the new dick.
Yeah, he's whipping it back and forth. He's basically helicoptering his dick.
I don't think Justin spoke about a hard on in his dick. That's not what he said, right?
No, it is not.
I mean, he might as well have.
I mean, all of his songs are about penises anyways.
Why don't we stay on a Justin Timberlake theme? How about this one? We all know this one.
Yeah.
I mean, really, this one can go with the penis surgery story.
Yeah, that's why I said all of his songs are about dick.
I'm bringing sexy back.
Yeah.
The mother boys don't know how to act.
Yeah.
I think it's special what's behind your back.
Yeah.
So turn around and I'll pick up the slack.
Yeah.
Do you guys, Lauren and Lisa, did you hear this in your head while you were walking at graduation?
No. In my head, I was hearing, like, cha-ching, cha-ching.
And that cash register was the sound of the school, right?
Yeah.
Correct.
For sure.
Like, hey, yo, that's 50 grand for a degree.
Oh, it was a lot more than that. Don't worry.
One more song. This is not JT, but I would call this guy the next JT. Nick Jonas. This is with Tuvlo.
Oh, damn, oh, damn, oh, damn. I'm so perplexed with just one breath I'm locked in. Oh, damn, oh, damn, oh, damn. I'm so perplexed on that it's almost shocking. I know, you're scared. Your heart, your mind, your soul, your body. Yeah. They won't be careful, but I guess that you don't know.
I feel at
me.
Peace when I listen to this song. It's very, very mellow.
If I want you, and I want you, babe.
Okay, so eventually in this song, he's like, close, so close, da 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 da.
What?
I literally.
What were you gonna say, Laura?
I literally cannot understand a word he's saying. So the only thing that I can say about this is that the part where he's like, "Oh," sounds like people in France when they get an email after 5 p.m.
Well, he starts the song saying, "Oh damn, oh damn, oh damn, I'm so perplexed. With just one breath, I'm locked in to this email you just sent."
That really describes perfectly how I feel when my email goes off and I'm home.
No, this reminds me of
100%.
I had a Nick Jonas. I ran into Nick Jonas 2 months ago at, you guessed it, the Bruce Springsteen concert. I went out for a beer in the middle of the show, and I get in line, and there's two lines, and I look to my left, and there's Nick Jonas standing in line for a beer. I'm like, what the fuck? This is weird. And then I tried to Snapchat him, but I couldn't get in at a good angle. You know, like when you try to take a picture of somebody, but you don't want them to know. I do it.
Why
all
don't
the
you
time.
Just ask him?
Because that's weird as hell. I don't do that. So I tried to Snapchat. I was so excited. I'd be like, oh, cool. I got Nick Jonas on my Snapchat just in line for a beer. And I couldn't do it.
You should have asked him what the fuck he was saying.
Nick, I heard your new single Close the other day.
Care to tell us what the hell you're talking
about? I think that's what it's called.
Is it about emails? All right. It's time now for Surprise Bitch. I know whatever listener we call is going to be thrilled to hear that Elisa is back on the show. So, Elisa, I'm turning this over to you now.
God help them. Oh, please don't do that. That's a mistake. I've been painting my nails this whole episode, and I think I have, like, a contact high.
How's that going?
It's, you know, it's going. It's a little sloppy.
Painting nails is hard. I did that for the Beyonce concert, and suffice to say, it was not very pretty.
Well, no,
Matt. I
don't
know how you guys do it.
And why did you decide to paint your nails during the show?
I gotta budget my time, yo. It's how I roll, okay?
You going out later?
No, I'm going. I'm going to like a big gala tomorrow after work and some like fancy thing where I'm supposed to pretend that I'm like, you know, high society.
Yeah,
I have to pretend like I give a shit and I'm real classy.
Okay.
And I figured I would not look like trash for it.
How many strokes of the brush have you done with your fingers so far? What do you say?
Well, with the nail polish, about two. But if we're talking metaphorically here, I mean, quite a few more than that.
Give me a number.
69.
Yes.
I think we've called number 69 before. Yeah, we
have. Oh, you were asking me for...
I was turning that into a game.
Well, okay.
If you couldn't pick 69...
not 69. Let's go with 49.
Okay, 49 strokes of the brush.
Yeah.
Caller 49 is Dylan. Dylan also painting their nails.
Hello.
Oh my god.
Yes.
Oh my god.
Please record your message. When you have finished,
oh, that should have been longer.
We all have to sing it. For more options.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, we do.
Hello.
Hello.
It's me, Millennial. We tried calling, but you didn't answer. Surprise, bitch. Yeah.
Hello from Surprise, bitch.
All right, cool voicemail. Thank you, Dylan. Sorry we missed you. Bye.
Bye. All right, let's try. We have to try one more.
Who would have guessed that Adele is a millennial listener? New rule. We'll leave you a voicemail if you've got a cool greeting.
New rule. Seriously fucking high right now. I've had 3 nail polish bottles open for the past hour. I'm fucking losing it. Let's roll.
I'm calling.
Hello,
Erin?
Hello?
Yes?
Surprise, bitch, it's Millennial. What's up?
Hey,
how are you?
Hey.
Good.
Where are you in the U.S. of A?
I'm in Columbus, Ohio.
Okay.
What Columbus! I don't know.
What are you up to there tonight?
Mostly just getting over a cold and playing on my computer.
Oh,
preach.
I mean, that's the best thing to do when you have a cold. There's really nothing else to do. So, we have everyone on the line here. We've been talking about a few topics, and we wanted to play No Context with you. You know this game.
Okay.
Right? Okay.
I think so.
we play a song, and you got to connect it to, since you obviously haven't heard the show yet, just feel free to connect it to any sort of news topic you know of over the past week. Okay?
Okay.
So I hope you're an Ariana Grande fan.
Oh my god.
Here's her song, Dangerous Woman. Sorry, it's a hit.
Don't need permission. Made my decision to test my limits. Cause it's my business. God is my witness. Stop what I finished. Don't need no holder. Taking control of this kind of moment. I'm locked and loaded, completely focused. My mind is open. All that you got, skin to skin on my neck.
So, how would you connect us to a news story that you've heard over the past week?
I don't know how I would connect it to a news story specifically, but it just makes me think of the election and Hillary Clinton.
Ooh. She's a bad bitch. What, you mean it positively, right? Or are you saying she's dangerous to our country?
No. She's being badass, you know?
Yeah. Okay, that's a good one.
I'm scared of her.
Scared of her?
I
wouldn't want to be on her bad side.
No.
Oh, no, definitely not.
Yeah. My
It's really interesting to see her and Trump go up in a debate.
Oh, I can't wait. My mom and brother went to a Hillary rally last week, and they got placed right behind her, which was kind of crazy.
Oh wow!
Yeah,
that's crazy.
Yeah.
What area does Columbus in particular lean towards? Do they lean towards left or white? Right.
left or white?
Probably.
Both.
Probably more left.
Yeah.
We've got a big gay community going on here and stuff.
Hey-o.
But Ohio as a whole is just kind of a swing. You can never know what's going to happen here. It's crazy. But
right.
I think, the Columbus area with all the college students and the gay community that thrives here and everything, I think it's mostly themes left, to be honest, if I remember correctly.
The gays.
Do you like Ohio? Did you grow up there?
I did. I'm born and bred, and I only left Columbus to go to college, and that was only an hour away. So, I'm a sad Ohioan who's just never left.
Oh, well, that's okay like it there.
Yeah, I love it. We have weather that I don't feel like it's going to kill me, so that's a plus.
Isn't the Columbus Zoo pretty popular? I hear it's like one of the top zoos in the entire country or world or something. Like, it's really prestigious.
I mean, I'm a little biased, but I think it's pretty popular. It's about 10 minutes away from my house, so that's great.
So what do you like to do in Columbus? Is there, like, something in particular? Do you hang out in the gay nightlife there?
Not much. I'm not much of a nightlife person. I'm so boring and old. My husband's a really big foodie, so we tend to check out a lot of the food that hangs out around here. There's a lot of really good food, and there's a lot of...
What's, like, Ohio's poutine? Like, what's Ohio known for?
I don't know that Ohio is known for anything specifically, other than, like, Skyline Chili, but that's more Cincinnati.
Skyline Chili.
But, like, in Columbus, there's a lot of different, like, ethnic groups represented. So you get, you know, there's German Village, get a lot of really good German food, and we got gastropubs, and
very cool.
Tons of different Asian food and stuff.
I want to ask you about penis transplants. I should explain a little bit. We just talked about this story. This guy in Massachusetts just got, like, the first ever penis transplant in the United States. And we were talking, like, how does that work for his wife, right? Like, is she going to feel like she's cheating on him? Is he going to feel like he's jacking off another guy? Like, what's the upshot here? And do you have any thoughts on this?
I think this is a serious question, guys.
Listen, this is an investigative fucking report. Oh, okay. Matt went in person. Matt went to Massachusetts in person to check this dick out. So,
It's not bad.
Gosh. Oh, well, that's good. That's good.
Yeah. It's a plus.
I mean, I think that would probably be a little weird for his wife, at least the first couple times, you think.
Well, he's actually single, so he is really excited to, get back out there.
He's got nothing to lose, right?
How would you react, though? How would you react if you're on a date with somebody and they're like, P.S., I have another guy's dick in my pants?
I don't know if I could react to that. That would probably just be one that's like stare and blink and just be like, okay.
It's not something you would put on like a Tinder profile.
No, but that's what I'm asking. It's like, what date number do you reveal that? Is it date number 2 or date number 22?
I mean, definitely not date number 1. That seems like, at least get a couple dates under your belt before you decide to reveal what's in your pants, regardless.
Yeah. I like you.
I would be okay with it.
I would honestly just not tell them and see if they notice anything different.
Laura, you're okay with what? Learning that somebody has a different dick on the first date?
Yeah, whatever. All right.
Would you be
well argued?
I mean, if it did work and everything was good to go and all the plumbing worked, like, would you like feel like scared that you might break it off?
Yes, absolutely. Yes,
because there is like that little hesitation, like, it's not really part of. It didn't grow with age or anything. It's a third party in there.
I mean, it definitely grew with age, just not his age.
Whatever.
I am okay. This has gone off the rails.
I feel like any medical doctors that we have who listen to the show are probably unsubscribing right now.
No, I think if anything, they're just driven to try to inform us. Like, I have so many more questions.
Well, Erin, I'm sorry for these people. I'm very sorry.
You know what? I listen to the show for a reason. It's for these wonderful conversations.
Okay, good. Maybe ask your husband. Would you
be comfortable donating your husband's penis for for his organs and stuff? I mean, God forbid anything happened. Because some families actually do it. No, but we did talk about this. Like, families wouldn't actually be okay with that, but they'd be okay with, like, lungs and livers and stuff. Like, why is it any different?
Maybe it's not. Maybe it's not.
I wouldn't say it's any different. It's just like, people donate their skin and stuff.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
I'd love to donate mine.
Oh, okay, good. We'll remember that. Thank you, Erin.
Thank you, Erin.
Thank you so much.
No problem.
Have a nice day.
Oh, good. And we'll talk to you later.
Thank you for your support. Have a good night.
Yeah, thanks.
Night. Bye.
She was sweet.
I heard people pouring something at the end of that call. Was that Erin or was that you people?
It was probably her.
She's like, oh.
She probably.
Why did I sign up for this?
I need a drink.
Probably taking shots.
You know what just occurred to me? Okay, I have a question, Andrew and Matt, for you guys. Something.
No,
so, like,
I'm ready.
In a hypothetical situation, you've lost your dicks. And the doctors come to you one day and they're like, we found a dick and it's all yours. We're just going to put it on. The only thing is, it's the dick of an 80-year-old man. Would you take it?
No.
Yes.
I wouldn't. 80 years old? No. Why would you?
Why not?
Because it's 80 years old. I mean, no offense. It's just a lot older than the rest of my body.
But 80-year-old men can still have sex.
I know. But still, I don't know. I'm not comfortable with that personally. So.
Oh, I would definitely do it.
So that wraps up today's episode of Millennial. Just want to plug a couple things. Our website, of course, millennialshow.com. Our Patreon. How could you forget our Patreon? We appreciate pledges. $2 a month, $5 a month. $5 pledges will get you access to After Dark. And by the way, when you sign up, you're going to get access to all the old After Dark installments, not just the new ones. So if you signed up today, you are going to have a lot of stuff to listen to, including our most recent After Dark, not including the one we're about to record right now, but our all pizza episode. Elisa, it was such a bummer you missed that. We talked about pizza for like 30 minutes. Our mouths were watering by then.
I don't know how you accomplished that. That's some kind of like Pulitzer Prize winning shit.
Oh, thank
like,
you.
How do you talk about pizza for 30 minutes? And
surprisingly, it was easy. Like, we had to stop.
Yeah. You know, when you talk about something you truly love, it just flows out.
Mm-hmm.
We actually got a review I wanted to read here on the air. It was from Jeremy. He said, this was ... something. So as you can see, everybody is raving about our pizza After Dark
A little
special.
Preachy, but yeah, it was nice.
A little preachy. A little preachy. To wrap up the show today, I thought I would search Spotify for the word penis. I feel like that's been a hot topic this episode.
Mm-hmm.
There's a song here called Detachable Penis by King Missile.
Oh my god.
Serendipity. Like, it's perfect.
Yeah, I'm really afraid to click play. I have no idea what to expect. I have no clue what genre it is. I hope it's country. Coming up in today's After Dark, we're going to do a AMA in our Facebook group. We asked our listeners to submit questions. We said we'll pick the 10 of the first 15. We got some really, really great ones. So we're going to answer those in today's After Dark installment.
Like what? Give us an example of what we're facing here, because I haven't looked at them.
Oh, man. I shouldn't talk about some of these while Mike is home. Where's the strangest place you've had sex?
Oh, let's do this!
That was the first question that came in from Sarah.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I have an answer for that.
Our people know us.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks, everybody, for listening. I'm Andrew.
I'm Elisa.
I'm Laura.
And I'm Penis. I mean, Matt. I'm Matt.
Here's Detachable Penis by King Missile. Okay, it's like rock.
I love it. I'm going to laugh if this is, like, my new song.
That's fun.
This morning with a bad hangover.
Oh, yes.
And my penis was missing again. This happens all the time. It's detachable. This comes in handy a lot of the time. I can leave it home when I think it's going to get me in trouble.
Holy shit.
Or I can rent it out when I don't need it. But now and then I go to a party, get drunk, and the next morning I can't, for the life of me, remember what I did with it. First I looked around my apartment and I couldn't find it. So I called up the place where the party was. They hadn't seen it either. I asked them to check the medicine cabinet, because for some reason I leave it there sometimes, but not this time.
Guys, we can make a song like this. This is so easy. Some guy's talking through an entire song and the other three of us are just singing some stupid phrase.
Detachable penis.
Detachable vaginas. Elise is just speaking monotone through the whole song. I woke up and my detachable vagina was missing.
We need to do this, seriously.
We really should. I need to get very depressed. It doesn't end. He just keeps talking. To Kiev and ate breakfast.